Welcome to Module 7 of the What Works Clearinghouse WWC Group Design Standards Training. You can access all of the resources mentioned in this module through the WWC's website, whatworks.ed.gov. This module focuses on the fourth step in the process of reviewing findings from group designs, which entails assessing baseline equivalence. This step in the review process is applicable to randomized controlled trials, or RCTs, with a high risk of bias due to compositional change, compromised RCTs, and all quasi-experimental designs, or QEDs. In this module, we will define baseline equivalence and describe why the WWC cares about it. We will identify when the WWC assesses baseline equivalence as part of study reviews, and we will demonstrate how to apply the WWC's baseline equivalence standard for individual level and cluster level assignment designs. Let's begin by providing an overview of baseline equivalence and why the WWC cares about it. The WWC uses the term baseline equivalence when determining whether the intervention and comparison groups were similar enough, that is, whether they were equivalent on key observable characteristics before the start of the intervention, which is the baseline. So, why does baseline equivalence matter? Imagine a study in which the intervention and comparison groups earned very different scores on a test before receiving the intervention. If the study also found that the groups performed differently after receiving the intervention, how would we know whether those differences were due to the intervention or to the fact that one group's members were already ahead before they received the intervention? If the groups were not similar when the intervention began, something other than the intervention could be causing any difference in measured outcomes between the groups. In other words, the estimated impact of the intervention might be biased. Recall that bias refers to a systematic difference between the true impact of the intervention and the estimated impact, which can lead to incorrect conclusions about the effect of the intervention. The WWC assesses baseline equivalence when there is reason to be concerned that the units in the analytic intervention and comparison groups may be dissimilar. Normally, random assignment gives us confidence that the groups are similar or equivalent on observable and unobservable characteristics. But if an RCT has compromised random assignment, or if the RCT has high risk of bias due to compositional change, then the intervention and comparison groups used in the analysis may not be equivalent. For QEDs, the groups may differ because the study did not form the groups randomly. Therefore, we cannot make any assumptions about the group's similarity at baseline in a QED. Let's discuss the two ways that the WWC assesses baseline equivalence. First, we'll talk about the right path. Because of the previously discussed concerns about the similarity of the groups and the potential for bias if the groups are different, the WWC requires all QEDs, all compromised RCTs, and all RCTs with high risk of bias due to compositional change to establish equivalence between groups on observable characteristics. These studies are eligible to receive a research rating of meets WWC standards with reservations. At best, these types of studies can only demonstrate equivalence on observable characteristics, and we don't know how much the groups may differ on unobservable characteristics. That is why these studies cannot receive the WWC's highest research rating. The WWC measures the differences between the intervention and comparison groups on a baseline characteristic using a standardized mean difference effect size. The WWC assesses baseline equivalence on each outcome measure to determine whether differences at baseline were small, meaning the groups were equivalent, or moderate, meaning the analysis requires a statistical adjustment to account for pre-existing differences, or large, meaning the groups were too different at baseline to meet WWC standards, even with statistical adjustment. As described in earlier modules in this training series, the effect size is expressed in standard deviation units based on the variation of the baseline measure in the analytic sample size. The WWC standard for baseline equivalence establishes the relationship between effect sizes and the three possible equivalence results. This slide illustrates the standard. If the absolute value of the effect size at baseline is between 0 and 0.05 standard deviations, then we say that the groups are equivalent, so the findings satisfy the baseline equivalence standard. If the absolute value of the effect size at baseline is larger than 0.05 and less than or equal to 0.25 standard deviations, then the WWC says that the study must use a statistical adjustment in the analysis to demonstrate equivalence. A statistical adjustment allows the analysis to account for the differences between groups that the study observed at baseline. We talk more about acceptable statistical adjustments later in the module. And finally, if the baseline differences is greater than 0.25 standard deviations, then the WWC says that it does not demonstrate equivalence. The baseline differences are too large for the study to address with a statistical adjustment. Now, let's talk about the bottom path. Some RCTs only need to apply a statistical adjustment for baseline differences to satisfy the baseline equivalence standard. For individual-level RCTs, this option is acceptable for uncompromised RCTs with high attrition assessed under the optimistic attrition boundary. These types of RCTs only need to statistically adjust for key covariates in order to satisfy the baseline equivalence standard. We describe appropriate adjustment strategies later on in this module. So, what characteristics are required to be equivalent? The WWC assesses baseline equivalence on characteristics that are relevant to the outcome, meaning those characteristics that are expected to have a strong association with the outcome. We'll now discuss the following guidance from the WWC Procedures and Standards Handbook, which clarifies the types of characteristics for which baseline equivalence is assessed. For student outcomes, the baseline equivalence standard may be satisfied using either a pretest in the same domain as the outcome or a pretest in a broader domain in the same content area and for which the outcome domain is a subset. Or, if a single pretest in a broader domain is unavailable, study authors may include multiple pretest measures that collectively represent a broader domain. For example, if the outcome measure of interest is in the life sciences domain, the baseline equivalence standard may be satisfied using a measure of general science achievement. However, if the outcome measure of interest is general science achievement, the baseline equivalence standard cannot be satisfied using only a measure in the life sciences domain. In some scenarios, a direct pretest may not be available. Perhaps the pretest was not reported by the study authors, or perhaps it is not applicable for a given outcome, such as high school completion, where we would not expect researchers to have a pretest measure. If a pretest is not available, the baseline equivalence standard can still be satisfied using a broad, approximately continuous, and standardized baseline measure of student academic readiness: knowledge or skills from one of the following domains: cognition, academic achievement, general literacy achievement, general mathematics achievement, or post-secondary academic achievement. Along with the baseline measure, the study also would need to report baseline information for at least two of the following characteristics of the sample: socioeconomic status, race or ethnicity, dual language or English learner status, disability status, disciplinary measures, grade level, and age. And for studies of intervention implemented for students younger than kindergarten or for adult education programs, the age of the learners. One important caveat: if the outcome of interest is a broad measure of knowledge or skills, such as standardized academic achievement measures, then using a broad baseline measure of knowledge or skills is sufficient for satisfying the baseline equivalence standard, and authors would not need to satisfy the standard for additional student or contextual characteristics. And it is also possible that some studies may adjust for baseline characteristics of participants through the design of the study. For example, if a study sample was composed of 100% English learner students in second grade, then the study effectively adjusts for English learner status and grade level of students. This table displays the acceptable baseline measures that can be used to satisfy the baseline equivalence standard for teacher and school leader outcomes. For outcomes in the teacher or school leader practice outcome domain, baseline equivalence must be established using the same measure as the outcome, or another measure from the same domain as the outcome, and at the same unit of analysis. For outcomes in the teacher or school leader retention, teacher attendance, and other teacher or school leader domains specified in the study review protocol, there are a few different acceptable baseline measures. This could include the same measure as the outcome or another measure from the same domain as the outcome and at the same unit of analysis. Or it could include the average years of teacher or school leader experience or the experience categories used in the study, in addition to an aggregate measure from the same domains as the outcome for the cluster or other cohorts. And finally, another option is to satisfy this with a broad measure of academic readiness, knowledge, and skills, as well as at least two of the learner characteristics described previously.